apology. So, contact shaving has been in widespread use for the last 60-70 years, aiming to protect against genetic effects and cancer. But since 2012, studies have begun to appear in the literature that question the continued use of such shaving, especially when radiographic technology has changed so much over this period. And this literature has culminated in several professional bodies, such as the American Association of Physicists in Medicine and the British Institute of Radiology, issuing guidance and statements recommending against the continued routine use of patient contact shielding. Many professional societies have also endorsed these statements, and national statements on the matter continued to be produced. And until a couple of years ago, the major European bodies involved in diagnostic radiology and radiation safety did not issue a statement on patient shielding. And this has led to inconsistency of patient shielding, not only among different European countries, but also among different radiology departments in the same country or region, and even within the same department. For all these reasons, a European consensus statement was very much needed, and therefore the main bodies in radiation safety and imaging in Europe formed the GAPS group. GAPS stand for Gonad and Patient Shielding, with the aim to provide a European consensus statement based on the best evidence available in published data and guidance. And the main aim of this consensus statement was to encourage good clinical practice by promoting harmonization of application of patient contact shielding. Just to make a long story short, the recommendations provided by this European consensus are that in the majority of cases, patient contact shielding use is not recommended anymore. And another aim of the GAPS group was to organize a European survey on patient contact shielding in order to gather information about its use among European radiology departments and about the attitude toward a non-shielding policy. Information came from 2,025 radiology departments from 35 countries which participated to a web-based survey. And as you can see in this slide, shielding in at least one radiological modality was still used in adults by almost 50% of centers and in children by almost 60% of centers. And centers using shielding were asked the reason why. And the most frequent answers were the effectiveness of shielding in reducing unnecessary dose exposure, the reassuring effect of shielding on patients and carers which feel confident about the care received, and the regulation which requires to do so. And the majority of centers experienced the need to repeat study for the superimposition of shield or artifacts, and also higher dose due to interference with automatic exposure control. Then, centers not using shielding were asked the reason why. And the most frequent answers were because shielding is not effective to reduce unnecessary dose exposure and because it may impair image quality and diagnostic capability. And the vast majority of radiologists felt okay with a no-shielding policy. All centers were asked what would be or what were the main challenges for implementation of a shielding policy. And the most frequent answers concerned the psychological aspects and the expectation of patients, parents and carers, and the difficulty of convincing imaging staff of the marginal benefits and risk of shielding. And finally, participants to the survey were asked if they would follow European recommendations if provided, and 84% of them answered yes. So, what is needed to implement a new policy about patient shielding? First of all, robust recommendation based on the best evidence available are needed. This recommendation should be provided by the European main scientific and professional bodies involved in radiation safety and diagnostic imaging, and endorsed by national societies. And last but not least, feedback from patient advisory groups is also pivotal. And I think the consensus statement issued by the GAPS group appears to meet these requirements. But guidelines and recommendations are not sufficient. And the continuous education of professionals is fundamental. In fact, a change towards a no-shielding policy can represent a paradigm shift for many professionals involved in diagnostic imaging. Therefore, European and national scientific societies, together with professional bodies, should be committed to the continuous education of practitioners. Then, information of patient encounters is of the utmost importance, as they are used to shielding, and the shielding means good practice for them. The whole staff should be able to explain why shielding is not used with simple words and really to anticipate questions. And information about shielding should be provided with leaflets and posters made available in the waiting rooms of radiology departments and made available also in the consent forms. Professional societies should also provide specific information aimed to patients and carers. So, in conclusion, the implementation of a no-shielding policy represents a paradigm shift for professionals, patients and carers. The education of professionals and information of patients are pivotal for the implementation of a no-shielding policy. And the switch to a no-shielding policy is not expected to be quick and easy. And the statements and recommendations should be periodically revised according to new evidence available. Finally, radiation protection authorities and regulatory bodies should be involved because of possible conflicts between recommendation and legislation. And thank you for your time and for your attention.